Wow. That's something. So let's maybe get started. Welcome to this workshop. And at first, let me say thank you. Thank you for being here at the conference and, of course, at my presentation, especially that we are in Amsterdam. So this beautiful town has so many interesting things to offer. But we here in this room know that the most exciting thing to do at this very moment is to talking about controlling texture coordinates. And well, if I wanted to talk about controlling them the standard way, I would probably just walk you through the options that we have in the mapping node. But we want to control texture coordinates like a boss. That's why I will go beyond the mapping node. I will show you such possibilities. For example, how we can distort the textures, or how we can blur the textures, which in fact should be just as easy as adding the blurring node. But in Cycles, we... it would be great. it would be awesome if we had the blurring nodes in Cycles, but we don't have ones, so we have to use workarounds, and I will be showing you those. Now, here are the other possibilities. Such distortions are also possible, and here is a little animation. I created this just using two gradient textures and some clever ways of manipulating texture coordinates. And let's now take a look at a more practical example. This is the render, and maybe there's nothing special about it, but I would like to tell you three things about it that may surprise at least some of you. Single material. When we, for example, take a look at this floor here, every single slot of it is a separate object, and I used just a single material for all of them, and the same applies to the chest here on the left, where every single element of it is a separate object, and just one material has been used for all of them. And you see the variations. You see that we don't have the repeating patterns. Every single element is unique. So you may think that maybe I spent quite some time on UV unwrapping those objects, which is not true because I didn't use any UV maps at all. What about image textures? What do you think, how many image textures did I use to create this render? And some of you probably already know that I didn't use any image textures. So everything has been created using just procedural textures and using some smart ways of manipulating the textures. Just a few words about myself. My name is Bartek Skorupa. I'm a Blender Foundation certified trainer, and I publish, this is my profile at Blender Network. I publish video tutorials on my personal website as well as on Blender Cookie. So here are some examples. From time to time, I write some add-ons for Blender, and I run a little post-production facility where we edit, do visual effects and 3D stuff for TV commercials. And I live not far away from here, just a walking distance. If I wanted to walk home from here, I would exit this building, turn right, pass just a few blocks on this crossroad, I would turn right again, and just a few more left and right turns, I would walk through Germany, enter Poland, and head straight ahead to the capital of Poland, Warsaw, my hometown. And it's a walking distance of 1,200 kilometers. According to Google Maps, it would take me 241 hours to walk home. I'm not a big fan of such long walks. That's why I decided to take a plane instead to get here. Okay, let's get down to business. So what I am going to talk about, I am going to talk about manipulating, controlling texture coordinates and a little outline. I will go through some theory. I will explain some of the coordinate systems and the basic transformations. Then I will show you how we can create distortions and blurs. And the practical example, I will show you how I set up this wood material that I used in the renders, in the render that I showed you at the beginning. So let's get started. just the basic. What? Just the basics. What we are talking about. At the left we have the texture, and on the right we have the object. And we want this texture to give its colors to this object. So we need a way to figure out which point of this texture should go to which point of this object. And of course, the most obvious thing to do would be to UV unwrap the object, and we have the result. Here we can see some other examples of UV maps and the results on the right. In order to be able to use those coordinates, in order to be able to use this system in Cycles materials, we need to use the texture coordinate node and the UV output of it that we simply plug to the vector input of our texture. And in this case, we are using the image texture. So even if we didn't plug anything to the vector input of it, UV map would anyway be used. This is the default. But I have a habit of plugging something into the vector input anyway, because other textures use by default the other coordinates. So procedural textures by default use generated coordinates. So we see how UV coordinates work. I will explain two more systems. The first one will be generated, and the second one will be the object coordinate system. Let's start with the generated. I have to go through the theory, such that we know that we are talking exactly the same language. So we have the texture on the left. We have the axis. Of course, the horizontal line is the x-axis. The vertical line is the y-axis. The origin of our image texture is the lower left corner. And here on the right, we see the object. And I have visualized the bounding box of the object, because in generated coordinate system, the bounding box is the basis of it. So we see the bounding box. We see the axis. And how this texture would get mapped on to the object that has such bounding box. Here I have marked the corners of the texture, A, B, C, D. And those will get mapped like this onto the bottom of the bounding box. Here we can see exactly the same bounding box, but from a little bit different angle. So when we are looking from this angle, this mapping seems a little bit more logical. This is how it how this texture will get mapped onto the bottom of it, and it will get extended all the way along the z-axis. Now, when we begin to kind of reveal the object, we see the result. So this is how the generated coordinate system works. This system has a little problem. We are losing the proportions. Here is exactly the same texture applied to three different objects. They have different dimensions, different proportions, and we see the stretching. And when we don't want to have the stretching, when we want to preserve the proportions, we can use another system, which is the object coordinate system. So now let me explain how this one works. Okay, again, we have the texture on the left and the object on the right. We know how the axis works on in the texture space. And remember that the origin of the image texture is the lower left corner. And this origin will be mapped to the origin of the object. The origin of object coordinate system is the origin of the object. The axes are exactly the same as in generated coordinate system, the local axis of the object. But what is the most important thing is are the units, so that are completely independent from the object's shape, from the bounding box, from anything like that. So the units are always one blender unit along each axis. So the total width of the texture will be mapped onto one blender unit along x-axis. The total height of the image texture will be mapped to one blender unit along the y-axis. So, and it doesn't matter what the size, what the dimensions of the objects are. So here we are looking at some smaller object. It's good to know that the scale of this object, as well as the scale of the previous object that I showed, is one. So we are simply looking at the smaller mesh. This is not that the object has been scaled down. No, it's a smaller mesh. So let's imagine that we want to map this texture onto such object. You see the units, you see the object. it will get mapped like this. Of course, one texture is not enough to cover the whole object, but the image textures simply repeat themselves to infinity, and this amount of textures is enough to cover the whole object. Let's now reveal the object, and this is how it gets mapped onto this object using the object coordinate system. And as you can see on this example, we have different objects of different dimensions, and we don't see any stretching. The scale is preserved and so on. But, well, this system is not perfect. It also has some disadvantages, especially when we are working with image textures that are not stylable. Remember that the origin of the image texture is the lower left corner, and this point marked with this white arrow on the left, and this point will be mapped onto those points that are marked with the green circles on the right. So when we are dealing with image textures that are not stylable, we may encounter some issues. So those are the points where the lower left corner of the image texture will be mapped. But when we are working with procedural textures, we don't have this problem. You see that I have applied the noise texture onto those objects. I have consistency in scale. I don't have any distortion. And for comparison, let's see how it would look like when we used the generated coordinate system. And we see the stretching. We see the lost proportions. That's why in most cases, when I am using the procedural textures, I am using the object coordinate system. And what I explained was just the starting points. So we defined the coordinates, but we, of course, can manipulate them to some extent. And we can perform some basic transformations. For this, we can use the mapping node. So here, we have a chance to change the location, meaning we can shift the texture, we can rotate the texture or the coordinates, or we can scale them. Now, let's take a look at the example of mapping the image texture onto those objects using generated coordinate system. And here in the mapping node, I have set the Z rotation to 30 degrees, and this is what happens. This is the result. The important thing, especially when we are talking about rotations or scaling, is the pivot. And as the pivot, always the origin of the coordinate system is used. So in case of generated coordinate system, is the lower leftmost, backmost point, so those points that are marked with those circles, if those are circles, are used as the pivots. When we used the object coordinate system, those points would be used. In fact, those points, the origins of the objects. Of course, in case of rotating around the Z axis, it doesn't really matter. But when we rotate along Y axis, it matters. This is the result, and let's take a look at some other rotations. Here I have set 30 degrees on each of the axes, and this is the result. Now, the scaling, let's say that I want to change the scale of the coordinates or of the texture, and here I have used the X value of 3. Now, I am using the default option in the mapping node, the point option, which means that I am operating not on the texture, but I am operating on the coordinates. So the result that we are getting is somehow counterintuitive. It's like reversed. So I am increasing the scale, but the scale of the texture gets smaller because I am increasing the scale of the coordinates. If I want to have consistent results, I should change this option from point to texture, but I don't want to do it, and later on you will see why. Now, so this is the result. I have increased the scale, but the scale of the texture got smaller. Okay, some other examples, different values for location, rotation, scale, some other values. And now let's imagine, bear with me. let's imagine that we don't have the mapping node at all, but we would like to be able to perform all of those actions. We would like to be able to shift, rotate, scale our textures or coordinates. Is it possible? Yes, it is. And in order to understand why it is possible and how it is possible, it is good to look at the coordinates themselves. At the moment, we are looking at generated coordinates. We are not looking at any texture that is applied to those objects using those coordinates, but we are looking at the coordinates themselves. So we see the colors, and what do those colors mean? Here are the values of the x-axis of the coordinates, and those values are stored in the red channel. And here we are looking at the y values, and those are stored in the green channel, and the z values are stored in blue channel. So we simply combine those three channels together and we have the colors. So we have the colors, which means that we can manipulate them exactly the same as we would manipulate any other colors. We can mix it with something, we can add something to them, we can multiply them by something. So let's say that we want to shift the texture, shift the coordinates, change the location. Here on the left you see the values that I wanted to use, 0.5 something on x, 1 point something on y, and minus something on z. It's good to know that changing the location, shifting the texture, shifting the coordinates is nothing more than simply adding something to the coordinates, which means that instead of using the mapping node, we can use just a simple mix node with the add blend type and simply add those values to the coordinates. So let's try to put those values into the second socket. So, well, I didn't have any problem with putting the x value into the red channel, y value into the green channel, but now I am trying to put this negative value into the green channel, so I simply type in minus 0.15, I hit enter, bam, disaster, I have zero. Well, it is simply, let's try to do it again, minus 0.15, enter, bam. Well, it's impossible to enter negative values into the values of the color, so I have to use the workarounds to be able to do it. So for this I will use just a combined RGB node. Unfortunately here it is also impossible to input negative values. That's why I can, for example, add the value nodes and plug them into each of the sockets, and here I have recreated the behavior of the mapping node when I want to shift the texture, shift the coordinates, and I have the ability to enter any value I want. Hey, come on, make it possible, please. To enter negative values into the colors, into the vectors. And thank you. Combine XYZ also doesn't allow to enter negative values. Vector?
You operate on vectors, so it should be like vector math.
But sometimes I would like to not to use add operation, but for example multiply or anything else. That's why, is it a difference?
If it just supports like multiplication in vector math, no, for colors, it's just negative.
Maybe. But it's impossible to multiply one vector by the other at the moment. Using the okay, please do, thank you. okay, now let's imagine that we want to change the scale. So here are the settings that I want to use in the mapping node. So I have set the scale to something different than the default of one. And it is good to know that changing the scale is nothing more than multiplying. So again, exactly the same procedure. Mix node, but this time with a multiply blend type, and I simply put the values that I want, and I have recreated the behavior of my mapping node when I want to change the scale. Now, rotation, is it possible to change rotation without the mapping node? It is possible. Here I have the scenario. I want to rotate the coordinates 65 degrees along around the z-axis. When I rotate around the z-axis, the z-axis itself doesn't change. The only x and y-axis changes. I need some formula. I need to know what would be the new x and y values, and I found the formula. So you see, well, we have to use a little bit of trigonometry, some mathematical formula. It doesn't matter. Okay, let's forget it, how it works. Just the mathematical formula. And we all probably know that almost any mathematical formula can be recreated using the nodes. So, well, we have to recreate this. I have done this. This is the node setup that does this. Well, it doesn't look very nice. So, well, but it's not a problem to group it. And I created three node groups. One is responsible for rotating around the X, one for Y, and one for Z axis. And that's it. And I can use them. But so just to sum up, when we add something to the coordinates, we are translating. We are shifting the texture. When we multiply, we are scaling. When we want to rotate, just a little bit of trigonometry can do it for us. But yeah, that's very important question. What for? We have the mapping node. So why should we even think about recreating this stuff? Well, simple answer. Let's take a look at two setups. In the first setup, we have the mapping node. And in the second setup, I have the mix node with the add blend type. And of course, the first setup can do more, because we can shift, we can rotate, we can scale. The second setup, the only thing that it is capable of doing is to shift the coordinates. But the second setup has one huge advantage, which is the socket. The socket where we can plug something. So we can, for example, plug some texture into the second socket, which means that we can use one texture to drive coordinates of the second texture. And this is cool, because using this approach, we can, for example, distort our texture. And for this, here I have created a simple setup. I took the generated coordinates and I added the noise texture to it. I added the noise texture to it and plugged the result into the vector input of my texture. At the moment, the factor of this add node that I used is set to zero, which means that this setup does absolutely nothing. But okay, I will, of course, increase this factor. So let's increase it to 0.15. And the texture, the noise texture that I use just the default settings of it. And that's the result. We have the distortion. And probably some of you may be wondering, what's this subtract thing? What is this? Why didn't I simply plug the noise texture into the add node? But I have done something to it. Well, what I did was I subtracted 0.5 from every single channel, from every value of the noise texture. And why did I do it? Well, this is what would happen if I didn't do it. I simply muted this subtraction. And you see that we have the shifting. And why is it happening? Well, when we analyze what are the values of our noise texture, those are the values. All of the values are something between 0 and 1, which means we are adding all of those values to the coordinates. So we are shifting the coordinates, and we are shifting them one direction. Some of the points will be shifted a little bit more because we are dealing with the noise. Some of the points will be shifted a little bit less, but they will all go one direction. Now, when I subtracted 0.5 from all of the values, now I am dealing with the range of the values between minus 0.5 to plus 0.5, which means that some of the points, this is the case, some of the points will go one direction and some of the points will go the opposite direction, so I don't have this additional shifting. Blur. When we have the setup for this basic distortion, blurriness is as simple as just changing the scale of our noise texture. The default setting is 5. I have increased the scale to 1000, and that's the result that I have. If I want to increase blurriness, I simply increase the factor of my add node. So here's the result, and here even more blurriness. So this is workaround, and you see the quality of this blur. This is not perfect, but in many cases, it works. Yeah, I am. Okay, so let's take a look at the wood material. that I used here in this render. I will show it to you basing on the floor. So here is the scene, the simplified version of it. As I told you at the beginning, every single slat of this floor is a separate object, and I apply a single material to all of them. And this material is as simple as you can see on the left. Just this, nothing more. Well, when we analyze wood, we don't have any transparency, translucency, refraction. We don't have to take care about this. The only thing that this material is made of is just a simple standard mixture of the diffuse and glossy. As the factor, and this is a standard thing. I think that almost everybody here in this room use this setup for almost everything. So we are mixing diffuse with glossy and use Fresnel component to control this mixture. And this allows us to control it basing on the viewing angle. So that's it. But there are some things that are missing. Of course, the diffuse color. We need something to define the diffuse color. And we would also like to have some bumpiness. So we need something to be plugged into the color input of our diffuse shader and something to be plugged into the normal inputs such that we can control our bumpiness. And for this, for bumpiness, I will, of course, use the bump node. So two things are missing, the diffuse color and the height input of the bump node. And for both of them, I will use exactly the same thing, which is the wood grain texture. I will colorize this, use this as the diffuse color, and the raw version of it will be used as the bumpiness. So as simple as simply shift A, texture, wood grain texture. Okay, just kidding. There is no wood grain texture. I had to create the wood grain texture. I created a group of nodes that creates the wood grain texture, and I used this for diffuse color and for the bumpiness. Let's take a look at this group. This is how it looks like when we open this. It's quite a few nodes, and I will explain how they work a little bit later. Let's, at the moment, take care about the shader itself. So we have our wood grain texture. It behaves almost exactly the same as any other texture. It has several inputs. The most important one is the vector input. So this is where we plug the initial coordinates. And it has some other inputs where we can control several parameters of our wood grain, but let's forget about it at the moment. And we have two outputs, the grain pattern itself and the vector output. This group creates the grain pattern, but it also plays a little bit with the coordinates, and I wanted to have the access to those changed coordinates, because sometimes when I want to mix this one with something else, using exactly the same coordinates is crucial. So, as simple as this, and it is all based on procedural textures, and for this, as in most of the cases, I am using the object coordinate system, and probably you remember why. I don't have any distortion. And that's the setup. So let's take a look at our scene once again. And here on the right, you see the whole floor. On the left, you see the single slat of this floor. The dimensions of it is like 6 centimeters by 2 centimeters by 30 centimeters. Of course, the scale is applied. When we look at the texture on the single slat, it looks like this, and on the right you see the whole floor. Now let's take a look at another object. How would this texture look like applied on the object of different dimensions, 1 meter by 0.5 meter by 3 meters? This is how it would look like. And here is the example. Okay, we have the object of such dimensions, 2 meters by 2 meters by 3 meters, and we see that this texture is not perfect, it's not infinite. But come on, are tree trunks infinite? No. I tried to recreate the real world. Tree trunks are also not infinite. We simply have to keep it in mind when we want to use this exact texture. Okay, object coordinates. And now the goal here is to randomize the pattern, because, well, every single slot at this moment is exactly the same, and probably this is not what we want. So I would like to randomly shift the texture. So I need the access to some random value. And well, I can use the input object info node, and the last output of it reads random. So I have the access to some random value, but it would be good to understand what this random value is. It is some value between 0 and 1, and this is the value that is generated per object. So every object generates its own random value, and here in the material we have the access to this value. So when we take a look at those values, the same material applied on several objects, and you see variations. So we have some randomness, and we can use this randomness. We can add this value to the coordinates, but well, because of the limitations that we have on the x-axis and y-axis, we don't deal with infinite texture. I would like to add this random value only to the z-axis. So okay, mix RGB, add blend type. At the moment I'm using the black color, so it changes nothing. Black means 0, 0, 0. When I add 0 to something, it changes nothing. So let me, okay, use the combine XYZ node, and I will plug this one into the second socket. This way I have the control over the individual axis. I will leave the X and Y axis at 0 and add this random output to the Z axis. And this is the result. And we have the randomness. Now, I would like to have a little bit more control over this, so I would like to multiply it by something. By some trials and errors, I found out that the value of 300 works best, so this is what I used. So I have the coordinates. I have the coordinates, I have my wood grain texture, and now the first output of it will be used to create the diffuse color and bumpiness. So creating the diffuse color, it will be just colorizing the grain pattern and mixing it with some other textures. Colorize for those additional textures, I will of course use those changed coordinates that I talked about earlier. So colorizing the grain pattern is as easy as simply passing it through the color ramp. Bam, it's done. Okay, now let's mix some more textures into it. I decided to use two noise textures. This is the result, the parameters of them, the amount of those textures. This is this was just a matter of trials and errors. I tried several combinations, and I found that those ones work the best. So I would like to use those ones and mix them with this colorized version of my wood grain pattern. Of course, for them I need coordinates. I will use those changed coordinates. So those are the connections, and this is how the first noise texture looks like, and the factor that it generates, the second noise texture, and the factor that it generates. And now I decided to pass the first noise texture through the color ramp simply to increase the contrast just a little bit and overlay this over the colorized version of my wood grain pattern. So mix node with the overlay blend type. And then, so this is before, this is after, and then I decided to multiply it with this other noise texture. So with this texture, this is the result. I found that it's a little bit too dark, so I decided to add some values to this texture before it is used as the multiplier, and here the output of it is just a diffuse color. So I have the diffuse color. Now, the bump map. As I said, I will use just the raw version of this wood grain texture. Of course, I passed it through the color ramp, multiplied it by something. Of course, it's just a result of some trials and errors. And this goes into the height input of my bump node that goes into the normal inputs of the diffuse and glossy shader. So this is the material in all of its glory. So you see on the left the initial coordinates, randomization and so on, then the wood grain texture, and how the diffuse color gets created, how the bumpiness gets created, and the mixture of the shaders. So yeah, here we can simply see it zoomed in, and the mixture of the textures. So, who wants to know how I created the wood grain texture? Thank you. So, Do I have time for this? I think that I do. So, well, I started with the object 1 meter by 1 meter by 3 meters. And the thing that I did, I simply applied a simple gradient texture to it, but I changed the type of it from linear to spherical, and this is what I came up with. Now, as you maybe remember, when nothing gets plugged into the vector input of procedural textures, the generated coordinates are used, which means that we are facing the problems with proportions and so on. That's why I want to use the object coordinates. So now I came up with something like this, and I want to extend it all the way along the z-axis. So for this, I will multiply the coordinates by something, and the values that I will use will be 1, 1, 0, which means that I don't change the coordinates along x-axis and y-axis. When I multiply something by 1, I change nothing. But I have shrinked the scale of the coordinates along the z-axis to 0, and we remember that we have kind of reversed result. So when I set the scale to 0, the scale of the coordinates, the texture itself gets extended kind of to infinity. So I have extended the texture all the way along the z-axis. Now, the thing that I would like to do is to convert the gradient into the rings. So for this, I use just a math node and change the operation to modulo. And this is what happens when I use modulo. And as a second value, I use 0.2. Let me explain how this works in a human language. So it's like, okay, what this operation does, it takes the range of the values. And simply starting from 0, it goes all the way up until it reaches the second value, in this case, 0.2. When it reaches 0.2, it starts all over from 0, until it reaches another 0.2, starts all over from 0, and so on, and so on. That's why we converted the spherical gradient this way into the rings. So when we decrease this value, for example, to 0.1, we have denser rings, and here we have even denser rings. Now, operating on all those decimal values is not very convenient. That's why I decided to plug something into the second input of this node, and I decided to plug the math node with a divide operation. It's easier to say 1 divided by 5 than saying 0.00 something. So, and this gives me some visual representation of what I am doing. When I plug this into the second input of this modulo node, this is what happens. Now I have 1 divided by 5, which means that I have 5 rings. When I increase this lower value to 8, I have 8 rings, and in this case, I have 20 rings, which is great. But I have a problem that I am losing the brightness. I am losing the brightness, and in order to restore this brightness, the only thing, the easiest thing to do is to divide those values by the value that I used as the second input of the modulo. So this is the setup that restores the brightness. And here's the setup so far. In the middle, we have this spherical gradient. I have marked it with the yellow color. On the left, we are manipulating the coordinates. On the right, we are playing with the values, with the colors of this texture. Now, let's try to use RGB curves that look like this, and let's plug them here. So right after the gradient texture, before this gradient gets modulated, that this is what happens. By using something like this, I am playing with the density of the rings. So you see that now we have huge density in the middle, then the rings are less dense and get denser and denser the further we go from the middle. So maybe it's time to increase the number of our rings. Let's set them to 50. This is the result. And well, we are seeing something interesting, but it doesn't resemble wood at all. We have to have some distortion. Everybody remembers how to distort the texture. We have to add something, and the best way would be to add the noise into the coordinates. So those lines indicate where I should plug some more nodes. So here I am simply organizing the space a little bit better, some reroute nodes and so on. So I am adding something to the coordinates. I have set the factor to zero just not to see the result. I simply want to prepare the setup and then I will be setting the values. So I am adding the noise texture. Let's try the default settings of the noise texture that I will plug into the second input of this add node. Bam. And now let's increase the factor all the way to one. This is what happens. Whoa, disaster. So we have several problems. Well, the first one is, of course, that everything goes one direction, but we already know why, because the values of the noise that we added are all between 0 and 1. So, well, we can simply subtract 0.5 from every channel. Bam, we plug this node here, and the problem is gone. Now, of course, the influence of this is a little bit too strong, so we can lower the factor. I will cut it by half, and that's the result. And let's also play with the scale of the noise that we are adding. Let's decrease it from 5 to 0.2, and that's the result. Now, this is the texture. I am using the texture, and I didn't specify the coordinates, but I would like to use object coordinates for every textures that I am using here. So let's connect object coordinates here, and here's the result. Wow, something that resembles wood. But, well, we have taken care about the bigger distortions. Now let's take care about some smaller ones, and for this I can simply duplicate the setup that I used here. So, okay, duplicating this add node, the texture, and so on. And I will simply use the second texture of some different dimensions. And I used the scale of 3 and decreased the factor a little bit. So I have one distortion, the second distortion, and that's the result that I have so far. Okay, we still have several issues. And now the first one that I would like to address is the harsh edge, where the pattern goes from black color all the way to white color, and then immediately it changes back to black. So I would like to have a little bit softer transition. And for this, I can just use the RGB curves node that I will plug after everything, and then add a point, move it up a little bit, and change the type of this point from the default of auto handle to vector handle. And then I can move it all the way up and almost all the way to the right, and then grab the last point, move it all the way down, and that's the result. I have the softer transition. So this is before and this is after. One problem is solved. Now, well, let's increase the number of our rings to 100. Bam, that's the result. And of course, this result is not interesting enough, so I have to mix some more textures into it. And I will, of course, do it right here. And again, just some trials and errors, noise textures. Those are perfect textures. You can create anything from them. So two more noise textures. The first one with such settings, the second one with such settings. I, of course, want to use exactly the same coordinates that I used for my gradients texture. So, well, that's the connection. And overlay one noise texture over my gradient and overlay the second one over the result, some different factors, and that's the result that I have. I also pass the second texture through some color ramp, standard thing. Just playing with the values and see if I get what I want. So that's the wood grain texture, nothing more. And well, I simply grouped it, and this is how it looks like. When on the left we are looking at our object from the top, on the right we're looking at our object from the side. And this is how it looks like on the object that has the dimensions 1 by 1 by 3 meters. Now, this is how it looks like on the object that has the dimensions of the slat of our floor. So, well, it's looking pretty nice. So I have grouped all of those nodes and decided to extract some data such that I have the access to them from outside the group, and here I've simply named them such that it means something to the normal human being. And this is the material in all of its glory, and that's the result. just to sum up, what were we talking about? About which point of the texture should go to which point of the object, nothing more. We were talking just about this. We know that we have several coordinate systems like UV, generated, object. We know the basic, the most important difference between generated system and the object system, where in generated we are losing proportions, in object system we don't lose proportions. We know that we can manipulate our textures, our coordinates by using the mapping node or the equivalents like add to translate, multiply for scale, some trigonometry for rotation. We know how to distort our texture. We know how to blur the texture. I have shown you how the modular operation works, which is pretty clever way of making more interesting patterns. We know that we have the access to some random values, and so we can randomize colors, we can randomize coordinates, we can randomize whatever. And then when we use all of those techniques in a clever way, using just a such simple mixture of diffuse and glossy shader is enough to create fantastic results. So I hope that you find the techniques that I showed you useful, and hope that you managed to remember at least one of or two tips, and will be using them in your future works. So that would be all, and I am open to questions. Thank you. I think it works.
I think it works.
Yeah.
It's very. Can you understand?
Okay. Ask the question. I will repeat
it. It might be a little out of context, but is there a way to use your method to add to normal maps?
Sure. Of course.
So
I keep using this all the time.
So you just plug both of them into an add node, and that works.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Why not?
No.
Depends on what you want to achieve. Of course, I understood the question, do I combine normal maps also with something? Yes, I do. And when we use the term add, I didn't understand this correctly as add the values together, you know, add the node. Okay, combine normals with something. So I was talking about some more general.
Maybe I could
thing,
give you an example. Let's say I have a normal map that I baked out, and I want to combine it with a bump map from a noise texture or something. And I want both to affect my mesh.
So
do we have
you
a
would,
NURB node? We don't, right? Like
you would. I think that you would. But. Yeah. Or multiply one by the other. Hmm? Would it work, do you think? No, it wouldn't. It wouldn't. Yeah, it will give some result, but not exactly.
I'll just try. Thanks for the input.
On the picture, there's in the middle a scratch which goes over three pieces
yes.
of wood. How did
yes,
you manage
I didn't.
To do this?
I didn't show. I didn't show it how I created this because you know we don't have time for such detailed explanation. But how did I achieve this? Of course, this is also done procedurally. My goal here in this render was to use only procedural textures. It was not. Okay, create an awesome render, but create it using just procedural textures. So, for this, to achieve this effect that something goes across several objects, I simply use another coordinate. I didn't use the texture coordinate node, but the geometry node and the position output of it. When you use the position, it uses the position, the global position, the position in the world. So I used those coordinates to make those scratches. And for those scratches, I used just gradients, passed through some color ramps, and rotating them, mixing together, something like this. A lot of playing and a lot of fun, really.
Yeah, is it possible to apply this randomness to particle systems? Like you have an object, and then does it each particle have a random number assigned also, or?
I don't know. I think I can, but you know, you have the output that says particle info.
Okay, thanks.
You have something like this, so you have the access to some data of the particle, but. Well, I didn't use it, so I don't know.
Hey, very good talk. Thank you. I got tons out of it. Two questions. One is, can you explain just a little more, what is the Fresnel node that was used right before the mixed shader?
Well, I must say that I don't know the science behind this, but in a human language, it's like we are controlling something basing on the viewing angle. So, for example, when you're mixing diffuse with glossy, you want more glossiness on the faces that are away from the camera, and you want more, less glossiness when you're looking straight ahead at the. And this Fresnel, okay. Maybe Sergey knows it better. I don't know. It, you know, some mathematical formula that just manages this. So, but again, in a human language, I am basing something on the viewing angle.
And the second question is, and this is probably trivial, but in the RGB node, curves, you changed it to the vector... handles type.
Ah, in the RGB curves?
Yeah.
Let me go back. I don't have, right now I don't have the, I mean, bam, 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 bam. Where is it? Oh. I think that
it went from the curves to the straight lines. I had never noticed that feature.
Yeah, it's like when you take a, when you just a few slides. You have. Come on, come on, come on, come on. The whole presentation in there. Hey, come on, did I really make such many? Yeah, I did. You have this. No, no, no. Okay, okay, forget it. You have this little, I don't know how it's called in English. There's something that's... Yeah, yeah, yeah. So you have this symbol, and you simply select the point and open this symbol, and you have vector handle, auto handle, or... something like this.
Thank you.
Hey, thanks first.
Thank you.
In your example, you were having the object info node to have the random value for every object.
Yeah.
But having a floor tile, and you're seeing like 500 wooden tiles, and having 500 objects, I think that really can get a problem with organizing your scene. So having 500 objects for just the floor and so on. And I was wondering if there was a quick way of using other coordinates maybe to generate
let me tell you, you know, this is just a demonstration of the possibilities.
Yeah.
Let me tell you how I do it in real productions. Well, I am using those techniques to generate the pattern.
Yeah.
Okay? So I can afford to create all of those objects and so on. But then I kind of bake it all into the texture. When I'm happy with the pattern, but I don't bake because, come on. So my baking is just placing the orthographical camera above the object and rendering it. Then I set the resolution and so on. And then when I render it, I use my render as the image texture.
Yeah.
But so I am using this technique for creating those image textures. I can, you know, talk to the clients. Are they happy? Yeah. Okay, and maybe I can change something in the pattern, blah, blah, blah. So, you know.
Okay, thanks.
Because the other thing is that, of course, when we use this for the final render, I am using, here, I showed you that I am using several procedural textures, some noise textures with huge scale and so on. And just imagine how much time it takes to render. It's like, you know, ages. That's why, okay, I use this at the stage of creating the pattern and then bake it into the image texture and use the image texture.
Okay, one more question. Do you ever use other coordinate systems apart from object, generator, and UV? Because there's a whole list in this first.
Yes, note. I use reflection. I use normals, that's obvious. Normals for relighting, for anything like that. Reflection. Sometimes I have once created the material, the shadeless material that mimics the behavior of, like, let's say that you have the world with the angular map or something, equi-rectangular map, and I played with the coordinates such that I plugged the texture using the reflection with a mixture of something, blah, 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 I don't exactly remember, and plugged it into the emission shader. So it's a shadeless material that render time is close to zero, but you have the impression of reflections from all over.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
This is mine, hey.
I take it.
All right.